First up was from Seabird of what's the most wild Jehovah's Witness belief?
What is the most wild Jehovah's Witness belief? That's a really good question. Oh, shoot. I meant to think about this before the podcast actually started. Let me think about some other wild beliefs, not just Jehovah's Witnesses. Let me give you an example of Scientology's most wild belief, or what I would continue, or what I would consider to be Scientology's most wild belief. I would call the Xenu story a pretty wild belief. Now, there are more harmful beliefs than that one. For example, the whole fair game doctrine thing, where you can say or do anything to anybody to bring them down if they're a suppressive person, if they're trying to, if you're perceived as harming Scientology in any way, then attacking them is justified. So that would be the most harmful for Scientology, but the most bizarre, the most wild or out there belief for Scientology, probably be the Xenu / Thetan ideas. I think the most bizarre belief for Mormonism is probably the idea that, this is a tough one. I'd say for Mormonism, the most bizarre belief is probably the idea that they had horses in America around the time that the Book of Mormon was set, or that Native Americans or certain tribes in the U.S. were descended from Israelites. That's a little bit bizarre. Or here's another one. The idea that Joseph Smith was capable of reading an ancient Egyptian document, that's pretty, like hieroglyphics, that's pretty out there, pretty bizarre, I think. And it's heavily debunked in the CES letter. If you guys have not read the CES letter, you definitely should. It's a really good read. You can find it on Amazon. I think you can find it for free in PDF form on the internet. For Jehovah's Witnesses, I would say the most out there bizarre belief is probably, I'm trying to think of something that's different from traditional Christianity. All right, here's one. The second generation teaching. That's a pretty bizarre belief. They believe that the end is going to come before the generation who lived in 1914 dies out, and that's already happened, so they had to come up with the second generation teaching. And the second generation teaching pretty much says, they didn't mean generation. They mean anybody who was alive at the same time as somebody who was alive during 1914. That's the time frame we're working with for the end. And like I've said this before, I think they've got another, if I'm being super ultra generous, they've got 25 years before that doctrine, which is fundamental, which is core to their belief system, before they have to change that. And then they're going to lose people over it. Realistically, they probably have about 15 years before they have to change it, before they're really thinking about that. They could not possibly have more than 15 to 25. I forgot about one of the strange beliefs that they have. And I don't think this isn't really codified exactly. This isn't in their doctrine, but somebody mentioned the Smurf story. Fepper mentioned the Smurf story in Discord. And I realize a lot of people probably don't know the Smurf story. I don't actually know the entire Smurf story exactly, but I'll tell you this, okay? It's more of a cultural thing than a doctrinal thing. It's not doctrinal at all. When I was little, I heard a story about this girl who came to the Kingdom Hall, and she had a Smurf in her bag, like a Smurf doll, you know, like one of those little plushy Smurf dolls or whatever. And the Smurf came to life and stood up out of the purse and walked out the door screaming expletives the whole way and was never seen again. This story was told to me as fact when I was little, seriously. And I asked questions like, what, tell me more, you know? They explained to me, I don't remember who told me, it may have been like a cousin or something. They explained to me that the Smurf being an evil thing, because Smurfs was evil, it was an evil show you weren't supposed to watch. The Smurf doll was possessed by Satan and it couldn't stand being in the light of Jehovah at the Kingdom Hall. And it came to life and walked out the Kingdom Hall, swearing the whole way out, and was never seen again. Now, if this was an isolated incident, if I just heard this from a cousin, they could have made it up, right? It's not made up by my cousin. It's everywhere. Almost, all right, any Jehovah's Witness who was in the religion pre, say, 2010 has heard this story, just about. It is so completely washed through the culture of Jehovah's Witnesses. I honestly have no idea how this story spread so rapidly. I've tried to research it, but it's all folklore and rumors and gossip. There's nothing concrete about the story. I just know that it exists through all of Jehovah's Witnesses. It does not make any sense. Really fascinating. But there are different versions of the story too. Like, some people say she had a storybook and it was about Smurfs, and a Smurf came out of the storybook and walked down the Kingdom Hall saying swears. Basically, fuck this shit, blah, blah, blah. So yeah, and some people say it was like a Smurf keychain. It just varies from person to person. But one thing is for sure, it permeates every bit of Jehovah's Witness culture. Just ask any Jehovah's Witness who's above, say, 25 years old, and they will tell you what they know about the Smurf story.
This one coming from Peanut Butter. You might have answered this before, but what are your thoughts on Mr. Atheist? I think he can be a bit confrontationalist sometimes. I don't really know the right wording.
Okay, about Mr. Atheist. I would consider him probably my best friend. We're real close. We talk a lot on the phone and things like that. I've been on his channel a billion times, although not recently. But I'm real close with him. Really, really good guy. I don't necessarily agree with his approaches all the time. You're right about that. Sometimes maybe he can get a little bit passionate about things, and I can understand that. I can understand that passion and why he feels that way, 100%. And that passion is in me too. But sometimes I try to take a different approach. That's really what it's all about. I try to take a more calm, objective approach to things that honestly do call for passion sometimes. So I get where you're coming from with that. But like I said, he's my best friend. So we can have disagreements and it's okay. Disagreements are okay on things. And really, this isn't even a fundamental disagreement. This is just a difference in strategies more than anything. But yeah, I would still endorse him 100%. One thing I did want to note, though, I don't actually watch his channel. I just know him as a person. Like, I just know what his personality is like more than anything. I don't watch his channel. I don't watch any atheist content. And he doesn't watch any atheist content either. He doesn't watch my channel either. And the reason is because we want our ideas to be originally ours. We don't want to, I don't know how to phrase this. We don't want to co-opt other people's ideas and work them into our content. We want our content to be our content. That's why I don't watch his channel. So it's hard to answer that question without knowing exactly what you're talking about, but I get a feel for what you're talking about because I talk to him. You know, and I know his personality and things, so take that for what you will.
This one coming from Seabird again, what's your favorite movie?
I don't know. I don't really watch very many movies. I guess I would have to say Pulp Fiction was pretty good. Avatar was pretty good. I don't know. I don't watch many movies. I'm sure I have a favorite that I'm overlooking, and I'll be disappointed in myself tonight at like 2 a.m. I'll wake up and be like, oh God, I should have said that movie. But yeah, I can't think of one right off the top of my head. Pulp Fiction was good, though. I liked Django Unchained. I thought that was a really solid movie, too.
This one coming from All That Jazz 93. I was doing a little bit of a street epistemology and asked Jehovah's Witnesses how they reconcile their doctrine of only helping other Jehovah's Witnesses with Jesus' parable about the Good Samaritan, which advocates helping everyone regardless of beliefs. If I were to ask them that, what kind of mental gymnastics do you think they would use to justify their position?
They would deny that. They would say, oh, we help everybody, we help everybody. But in reality, actually, they do not. Let me tell you what they do. They only ever do charitable work for other Jehovah's Witnesses. They only ever donate money to other Jehovah's Witnesses. They only ever do home rebuildings. Like when Hurricane Katrina hit, they were sending some Jehovah's Witnesses down to Louisiana, to New Orleans, to rebuild homes of other Jehovah's Witnesses. But they weren't rebuilding for anybody else. They only ever help other Jehovah's Witnesses. But here are the mental gymnastics they use. By preaching to other people, by trying to bring them into the religion, they're helping them. So that's how they help other people. And they would be able to justify saying, we help everybody, by telling themselves, well, we preach to this group, and then we actually help that group. So we're basically helping everybody. Those are the gymnastics they would go through. I don't know that I would take that route because it would be a really easy pitfall for them to kind of hurdle over pretty much.
This one coming from Trigor. I'm gay, and I'm still having some troubles with my mother with me being gay. What do you think's a good way to work around this issue?
That's a really tough situation. All right, here's the question. Does your mother know that you're gay? Okay, she knows that you're gay. And she's just unaccepting of it? She doesn't really want to accept it? It's a hard situation. I don't know how many of my audience know about street epistemology, but it's something that I've picked up and run with a lot. It's what I would call my deprogramming techniques, and it's kind of a moderate, calm, non-confrontational method of getting people to come to true conclusions, or correct conclusions. So a lot of people have these ideas in their heads that being gay is evil or whatever other thing. If you non-confrontationally ask probing questions, it may not work in your case because she already knows that you're gay, but it may be worth a try anyways. Actually, I have a couple of videos on how this works. They are called How to Deprogram a Religious Extremist, parts 1 and 2 on my main channel, if you guys want to take a look at it. That may be helpful to you, but she's going to give you some logical fallacies for why she doesn't like it. So try framing those logical fallacies in a new way to kind of illustrate why that logic doesn't follow. And like I said, stay non-confrontational through the entire thing. And she may open up and understand, and she may make the connections in her brain. It's really complicated. I hope you're going to therapy over this. It seems really, really important to talk to a therapist about this, because I know that it's really, really hard to deal with. I did want to touch on some super chats real quick. I got one from Omega Riley, as always, as usual. Since so many people are watching, I'm shooting this out early. Make sure everyone watching the stream leaves a like. I love you, TT. Thanks. Since Gray Young Wolf can't send a super chat, I'll cover the tab. This one's for you, homie. Oh, that's awesome. Thank you again, Omega Riley. Jesus, this dude is really serious about donating. Also got another super chat from Nervardia. Thanks for being awesome, Telltale. That's great. Actually, you know, just quick side note, since Nervardia's name showed up, I've seen Nervardia around Twitter a lot lately. They're heavily involved in everything that's been happening there. New YouTuber. Check that channel out if you haven't. Kind of interesting. I took a look at it. Pretty cool person. So thank you. I appreciate the super chat.
This one coming from Trigor. I wanted to ask you what you think of Jehovah's Witnesses around the world. For example, I live in Denmark, and here they don't seem to be as extreme as in the U.S., I would love to hear your perspectives on different cultures and Jehovah's Witnesses' responses to them.
That's a good question. The further away from the headquarters you get, basically, which the headquarters is in New York City, of course, the further away you get from the headquarters, the less of a hold it has on people, but it still has a hold on people. They are a little bit less extreme, but it's still there. They're all still trained in the same way. They all still believe the same things, and they all still largely practice the same way. Sometimes you'll run across a congregation who won't hesitate to report to the police, you know, if there's some case of abuse. And that's a good thing. There are some cases where people will be okay with you dating a non-Jehovah's Witness. There are some cases where they'll be okay with you talking to a disfellowshipped family member or something. But the belief system is inherently really harmful in many ways. And the bite model, which I've talked about a lot on my YouTube channel, still applies in a lot of ways. Even if the worst parts of the religion don't apply as strongly, they still do apply in many ways. And they still max out the bite model in other ways. So that is something to consider. That's a good point. If you like what I do and you want to make sure I can continue to do it, you can support me in a few ways. First, you can support me on Patreon. That's probably the best way. But if you want to get something back for your support, you can check out my Teespring. I'm trying to make a shirt design for every cult I've covered. I haven't gotten everyone, but I'm working on it. So check it out and see if your cult is up there. Second, you can support me by checking out my game shop. I sell controller, cartridge, and game box stands for every system from the original Nintendo and Sega Game Gear to the Xbox One and Nintendo Switch. So give that a look too. And And finally, if you want to support me in some way other than monetarily, you can check out my other YouTube channels. I have a retro game channel where I answer questions like, why does Shy Guy have a mask, and why are CRT TVs the best way to play retro games? I also have the podcast where I talk about stuff I don't feel I can say on a monetized channel. And finally, I have my main channel where I talk about cults. I wish I didn't have to worry about dancing around subjects carefully in the first place, but I chose to do this as a full-time job, so unfortunately, I rely on YouTube's AdSense and on the support of patrons to continue doing the work I do. Anyways, check me out in all those places if you haven't already. Thanks for listening, guys.